Hello and welcome to this special episode. The Finance Minister, Pranab Mukherjee, today released the first draft of the new direct taxes code that will replace the 1961 income tax code and other direct laws. Here it is. The aim, according to the government, is to make the tax structure simpler for better compliance, and by the looks of it, at least on the income tax front, one can expect perhaps less taxing times. Let's take a quick glance at what changes you can expect in this new tax code, the draft tax code on the personal tax front. No taxes up to an income of 1.6 lakh rupees, 10% tax on income between 1.6 and 10 lakh rupees. For income between 10 lakh and 25 lakh, flat tax of 84,000 rupees plus 20% on the exceeding amount. Income above 20 lakh, 5 lakhs will have a flat tax of 3.84 lakhs plus 30% of exceeding amounts. New tax codes will abolish STT MAT to be 25.25% of gross assets for banking firms and MAT to be 2% of all gross assets for other sectors. That's the broad sense and some few takeaways from the new draft code that we've seen being unveiled earlier this evening. Now, we've got a special panel of guests here along with my colleague Arun Giri, who joined us. Uday Ved, tax head KPMG India, T.P. Ostwal, chartered accountant, and also Anish Thakkar from partner Ernst & Young, who's also joining us here in Mumbai. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Before we sort of move on and get down to the specifics, and we promise to do that very quickly, let's get a sense of what the anticipation was in the run-up to this. And let's get an objective view from Arun on that.
Oh, I'll try to be objective. The anticipation was extreme, a simple tax code. In terms of the way it's been structured, it seems quite simple. The language we'll pour through over the next few days, 297 sections in the earlier act, 285 year. Is it voluminous? Yes. But what did Mr. Chidambaram say today, the former finance minister who was the brain behind this new direct tax code, as Pranab Mukherjee himself said, do not see the length. There are other tax codes which are four times this. Look at the structuring. So we need to look at the structuring. And yes, when you look at the structure, Govind, there is a lot of elements which are radical. Uday and TP will tell more about it. But there are a lot of radical elements in this.
Right. So, and we'll try and understand what those radical elements are. But before that, let's get two views, one from Uday and one from TP Ostwal. On the three takeaways that, or the one key takeaway that you've got or had after going through this report.
I think there are three objectives of this direct tax code, which Finance Minister mentioned, which is simplification, certainty, and bringing stability. And I think the way it first cut impression, all three objectives seem to have been achieved. And I think this is a good welcome move, as Arun said. Although the number of sections may be still more, it looks like that this objective will be achieved. At least people know how they are going to be taxed.
Okay, so that's quite critical.
The certainty is a very important part.
Right, Mr. Ostwal?
Yes, certain structural changes made in the direct tax code in relation to various provisions of the Income Tax Act are far-reaching, and they are welcome to a great extent. And if they are implemented appropriately in the same manner in which is suggested, I think it will bring home the international practices in the country.
Right. One of the points that the former finance minister made was that do not look at the old book, as in he was referring to this fat book here, and he said, forget about it, this is a new code which has been written from scratch. Does it look like that?
Yes, it looks like, because, you know, look at these provisions of computation of business income. The explanation which is provided in this discussion draft, this is, we have looked into the practices of USA, UK, the Australia, and some of the other Canada and some of the other developed countries. And they have compared the systems of taxation of the business income. They have classified the business assets into different segment of business assets, investment assets and the business assets. And that's a concept which is prevalent in a number of European countries also. Right. And I think this will harmonize the tax base of India with other countries as well.
Right.
And so many issues on interpretation of the double tax avoidance agreements, etc., will get simplified.
Hopefully. Right. We also got Anish Thakkar from joining us. Anish, your takeaways, or the one takeaway for you from whatever you've seen?
I think the one key takeaway that I see it is that it is going to improve a lot of compliance. The simplicity and the certainty is going to improve compliance to a great extent. Therefore, the government is going to hopefully get higher taxes, and in a way that the finance minister said in his speech that it's not going to burden the citizens.
Right, Anish, thanks for that. Let's go across, let's go sort of now to some of the specifics, and let's begin at the personal level, which is really you and me and how we're going to get affected. Of course, our tax experts here perhaps will belong to a slightly different bracket, we would think. But anyway, let's begin with you, Mr. Ostwal. Personal tax, what can change and what will change?
See, in the personal taxation, basically what we have seen that the the limits which have been changed so significantly, so radically. Now, up to 1.5 lakh, 1.6 lakhs income, there is no tax. Up from 1 lakh 60,000 to 10 lakhs of rupees, 10%. I think I am reminded of the old saying that if the income level, exemption level goes up, the income of the people generally will go up. Right. And therefore, people, I am sure 2 years before we had only 76,000 taxpayers who were reporting income above 10 lakhs of rupees. But now we will find a huge tax base improving and number of taxpayers coming up in the tax bracket about 10 lakhs of rupees.
Just a clarification for both Uday and Mr. Oswal. I just wondered whether this is gross salary, whether this would be gross salary and therefore, you know, there would be no deductions from gross salary. So that may not exactly be the case.
As far as the salary is concerned, there are deductions which they have provided. He has said certain perquisites will be taxed as a salary. Now, there is nothing like a salary, perquisites, etc. And certain items will not be treated as taxable. There will be permitted deduction. For example, professional tax paid, allowances to the transport allowances, and the special allowances or benefit which meets the expenses wholly and exclusively incurred for performance of the duties. Now, this is very general. They will be possibly specify some of the items.
But no house rent allowance.
No?
No house rent allowance exemption, no, which is critical for millions of taxpayers.
Yes, house rent allowance unfortunately doesn't appear to be here under this section, but maybe one has to look at the incentive provisions whether it is there or not. Here it doesn't appear.
Yeah. Right. So, Uday, how do you see the impact on the personal front, and we'll come to the corporate and the other fronts later.
No, certainly I think the slab rate going up to 10 lakhs, I think a very welcome move, and I would believe rich will become a little bit more richer than before. And this will also lead to, I think, better compliance on a larger basis, I think. That possibly is the objective of this entire amendment. So I think you lose out tax at some level, but the number of taxpayers which will increase because of this will be many more.
Right, right. Anish, your takeaways, we're talking about personal to begin with. What fundamentally changes for my life or your life, let's say in April 1, 2011 onwards?
On a macro perspective, I see the spending going up because the tax slab going up, which means a reduction in tax liability will increase a lot of spending and will fuel economic growth.
Mm-hmm. Right. And do you see on the micro front, I mean, you know, do our lives become simpler? Do they become more complicated? Will we pay more tax or less tax?
We certainly pay less tax, all of us. And that is very welcome. In terms of the structure, it looks pretty simple. So hopefully, if it's administered well, I think life will certainly be simple.
Right. Anish, thanks very much for that. Arun, you have another point?
Yeah, absolutely. EET regime. That was something that, if I recollect correctly, the Kelkar committee suggested something that there was an EET committee as well. Exempt tax regime, which is something the government wanted to bring for many years. It is there in the new tax code, which means you will exempt tax code means in the year in which the tax saving instrument is withdrawn or it matures, those will be taxable. So there is no permanent exemption as such. Those exemptions will be taxable in the year the tax saving instrument matures. It is something that the then Finance Minister Chidambaram said,
right.
It is according to the global practices.
Right, last few words
that,
on
that,
the personal.
That amounts
yes.
to deferral of, you know, if you are defer, you are allowed to defer your tax liability.
Right, right, Uday?
Yeah, I think it is amounting to deferral of tax liability, but one would need to see that those instruments which have already been taken prior to 2011, whether there will be grandfather clause or not. Because,
right.
you know, somebody who is taken, as an example, an insurance policy today or, you know, invested in a PPF or, you know, whatever, tax exempt, when he withdraws, today it has been taken with an objective that when I withdraw, it will not be taxable. So whether there will be a grandfather
yeah,
tax.
So I think which brings us to two points. One is, of course, the corporate part, which we'll speak about. We'll also speak about the transition and how that should be handled or what are the issues that come up there. But we take a break here on this special discussion on the implications of the new draft direct tax code. Stay with us.